What are the different tests to confirm hypo and hyperthyroidism?
So the tests for thyroid are T3, T4 and TSH. T3, that is triiodothyronine, and T4 means tetraiodothyronine, something with 4 iodine. And TSH is thyroid stimulating hormone. These three tests can tell us about lot of, they give us lot of information about thyroid function. In hypothyroidism, what happens is, if the thyroid gland is functioning less and the levels of T3, T4 are going down, the pituitary gland would immediately increase stimulation and increase thyroid stimulating hormone or TSH, so that now the thyroid gland can function again normally. So a high TSH is the first sign which happens, and it points towards hypothyroidism even before symptoms appear. So that stage when there are no symptoms and T3, T4 are normal and just TSH is high is the first stage of hypothyroidism, also called subclinical hypothyroidism. In hyperthyroidism, it's the other way around. The levels of T3, T4 are high and therefore TSH levels go down. So again, if only TSH is low and T3, T4 are normal, which sometimes may happen, that is called subclinical hyperthyroidism. But if T3, T4 are also high with a suppressed TSH, that is clinical or overt hyperthyroidism. There are certain tests which are done to check for autoimmunity. Sometimes they are useful in making treatment decisions. They are not routinely required in all patients with hypo or hyperthyroidism. So if someone needs to see that now the TSH level is slightly higher, should I start treatment or not? That's an important decision to make, because if TSH is less than 10, many a times it may normalize after some time. Many a times it may progress after some time. So the presence of antibody, one of which is anti-TPO antibody or anti-TG antibody. So antibody against thyroid peroxidase is called anti-TPO antibody, and antibody against thyroglobulin. These are molecules which are present in the thyroid gland. So if we can detect antibody against those molecules, they tell us that the chances of progression are higher rather than reversal. So then one may think of starting treatment sooner. If TSH is more than 10, we usually start treatment. That is an indication to start treatment, because the chances of progression increase with a higher TSH level. Also, a high TSH may be associated with some future risks of bone disorders and heart disorders. And then one may not want to do a TPO test. So anti-TPO is indicated when the TSH level is somewhere where we don't know whether to start treatment or not and you want to take a call. In Graves' disease, there is another antibody called TSH receptor antibody. Again, the test is done in specific situations when we want to see what is the chance that you may have to do radioiodine ablation. Or if a woman is planning pregnancy, it again gives us information of how that is going to impact the pregnancy. So there are specific conditions in which we also check antibodies. There are certain imaging techniques we use for evaluating thyroid. As we discussed in thyroid nodules, ultrasound is an important imaging technique to evaluate thyroid nodules. There is a radionuclide scan we do, especially in people who have high T3, T4 levels and low TSH. So high T3, T4, that is high levels of thyroid hormone, can be because the thyroid gland is working extra, which is called Graves' disease. And if we do a nuclear scan, it will show hyperactivity. So either a thyroid technetium scan or radioiodine scan, which will tell us whether the thyroid gland is working extra. But sometimes the thyroid hormone levels are high, but the scan shows low activity, which happens typically in thyroiditis, in which the gland is inflamed and therefore the stored hormone level is all in the blood. So the blood levels of T3, T4 are high, but the gland is not working extra. So therefore this technetium or radioiodine scan is used to differentiate between these two conditions, which is hyperthyroidism and thyroiditis. So these are all the tests for thyroid dysfunctions which we do depending on what we are trying to look at.
How frequently should a person get tested for thyroid disorders?
So if you have recently started medication, then we want to see if the dose for thyroid medicine is correct or not. So in hypothyroidism, when we start treatment or when we make any changes to treatment, we usually check at 6 weeks to know if the dose is correct or not. If TSH is high, then that indicates that we have undercorrected. We have given little less of thyroxine and we need to increase the dose. If TSH is low, that tells us that the dose needs to be reduced a little bit. Once the levels are stable, then we can continue monitoring once a year also. In hyperthyroidism, the thyroid anti-thyroid medicines need to be tapered off quickly or changed quite rapidly, and usually monthly tests are done. If someone is planning pregnancy, then of course we do before pregnancy and monthly during pregnancy if the woman has hypo or hyperthyroidism. So again, frequency would be higher in kids, for example. Earlier in neonates, as we discussed, we'll do tests maybe monthly initially, and later on at least once in 3 months. So the frequency changes depending on who is affected and what we are monitoring.
A patient is taking treatment, but the TSH levels are not normalizing. What could be the reason? What should be done?
I think it's the right time to discuss about what I missed in the medicine. So when if someone is taking medicines and TSH is not normal, number one, it may be that we have not given the right dose for you, because TSH is used as an indicator to check if we are giving the right dose or not. Number two, this medicine is not absorbed completely, especially if there is something else in the stomach, especially if there is some milk or tea or coffee in the stomach. So it has to be taken empty stomach, and then a person needs to remain empty stomach for at least half an hour after taking the medicine. So you have to ensure that you're taking the tablet empty stomach and then recheck the thyroid function. Third is the medicine is affected by humidity and temperature. So if you're keeping the bottle in the kitchen or bathroom or humid conditions, that may affect the quality of the tablets. It may also the store from where you are buying the medicine is therefore also important, because fake medicines for thyroid are also present sometimes. So check, get it from a right store, store at a proper place, eat it at a right time. Still, if TSH is not getting adequately controlled, or if it fluctuates a lot and you suspect that there is some malabsorption, which might happen because sometimes hypothyroidism is associated with celiac disease. If someone has one autoimmune disorder, there is always a higher suspicion for another autoimmune disorder. And one such autoimmune disorder is celiac disease, which is also called gluten sensitivity, in which the absorption of the tablet may be affected. There is a simple test to rule out, a blood test to screen for celiac disease, and then we usually advise this test to figure out if that is the reason for medicine not getting absorbed properly. If someone is on iron or calcium supplements, that can also affect absorption of the tablets. There are certain medicines, there are certain supplements like biotin which may influence the report, TSH report or the assay. So recheck all the medicines for any possible drug interaction. Check the tablet, check whether it's being taken empty stomach. I think these are important factors. Also check whether you're taking it regularly or not. For some people it is very difficult to remember taking medicine every day. I am one of those. So maybe you can put an alarm, or what we advise is keep weekly tablets in a separate bottle. So because thyroxine is a slow acting medicine, it's the weekly dose which matters. So if you have missed one or two tablets in that week, just take it at the end of the week. So you should finish that one bottle of tablets at the end of the week, as that itself might work. So I think these are most of the things which need to be seen if TSH is not coming down.